गुड आफ्टरनून एवरी वन. इन दिस लेक्चर आई वुड लाइक टू ड्रॉ योर अटेंशन टू द मेजर कैरेक्टर एनालिसिस एज एक्सप्रेस्ड इन द प्ले एडवर्ड सेकेंड. कम टू द नेक्स्ट. सो बिफोर वी स्टार्ट आवर कॉन्वर्सेशन, द फर्स्ट इम्पॉर्टेंट थिंग दैट आई लाइक टू ड्रॉ योर अटेंशन दैट इज सम ऑफ द फंडामेंटल फीचर्स ऑफ मार्लोवियन ट्रेजेडी. So what you generally come across in when you read any tragedy by Christopher Marlowe? In Marlowian tragedy, generally we see one man show. One man show, this indicates that in Marlowe, you do not get many characters. You do not get many important characters. If you read Dr. Faustus, then Dr. Faustus himself is the only important character. If you read Edward II, then undoubtedly in the play Edward II, probably younger Mortimer is the prime character, is the most important character. So the first important thing about Marlowe's tragedy is it is one man show. The second important feature of Marlowian tragedy is that in Marlowian tragedy, it does not feature many characters. Meaning, when you read any Shakespearean tragedy, you get some 30 characters, some 40 characters. But in Marlowe's tragedy, for example, in Dr. Faustus, you get hardly some 9 to 10 characters. And among 9 to 10 characters, there is only one important character. Similarly, in Edward II, there are only three important characters, that is Edward II, Gaveston, and younger Mortimer. These are the most important characters. And women characters are almost absent. We have only Queen Isabella as a major woman character. What is the third important character? The third important character of Marlowian tragedy is that Marlowian tragedy has episodic plot. That is very important. In fact, we have two types of plot. We have linear plot and we have episodic plot. What is linear plot? When middle arises from beginning and end arises from middle. Middle comes from beginning and end comes from middle. That is called linear plot. And what is episodic plot? When regarding episodic plot, what is episodic plot? In episodic plot, the end directly comes out from the beginning. Meaning there is no such middle as a thing. So that is very important that Marlowian tragedy always offers you episodic plot. You read Dr. Faustus. In Dr. Faustus, there is only beginning and the end. The middle is almost absent, that is weaker middle. So Marlowian tragedy always offers weaker middle, meaning in the middle, there happens almost nothing. The last important feature of Marlowian tragedy that Marlowian tragedy could not ignore the English Renaissance. English Renaissance had many such features, many such influences. The first influence is undoubtedly unlimited quest for power, unlimited quest for knowledge. Okay, greater the knowledge and larger, deeper the suffering. So these are the important features you generally come across in Marlowian tragedy. So in Marlowe, probably you can never ignore English Renaissance, the spirit of the English Renaissance. Now come to the analysis of the character of King the Second, Edward, in fact, King Edward the Second. So when you concentrate on the character King Edward as a king, then undoubtedly, history addresses King Edward the Second as a weaker king. Unlike Richard the Second, unlike Richard the Third, King Edward is not a strong king, is a weaker king, almost callous to his royal responsibility. So Edward II as a king is weak, negligible, neglectful, and almost indifferent to his responsibilities. Okay, royal responsibilities. The second important thing is King Edward II as a husband. Okay, as a husband, he is once again very disinterested in Queen Isabella. The moment he gets his friend Gaveston, in the accompany of Gaveston, he always starts neglecting her, his wife, Queen Isabella. So King Edward II, as a husband, cannot be called a complete one. The moment he enjoys the company of Pierre Gaveston, he starts neglecting Queen Isabella, and thus Queen Isabella becomes a miserable woman. Okay, King Edward II as a friend. When you assess the character of King Edward II as a friend, undoubtedly, there was a famous utterance in the play where King Edward II describes Pierre Gaveston as if King Edward II and Gaveston, they are one existence in two different bodies. Okay, so about friendship, King Edward II is very, very obsessed and very, very serious. He cannot imagine a single day without his friend Gaveston. And that's why what happens here, right after becoming the King of England, he invites Gaveston back. Gaveston, who was earlier banished by his father, Edward the First. Edward II as a father is also very, very neglectful, but he hopes, though as a father he is not a complete figure, he does not pay much attention to the son, he is obsessed to the friend, but Edward II, he hopes that his son, Prince Edward, will be a better ruler. So this is another important aspect of the character of King Edward II. As a ruler, he knows that he cannot achieve anything, but he hopes that his son, Edward III, Prince Edward, will be a successful ruler. King Edward II as a worshipper of idealism. So just I would like to draw some one or two episodes from the play. When Gaveston was banished to the tower, King Edward starts lamenting, and King Edward II mentions that probably he will sign the bond of Gaveston's banishment with his tears, even if not with the tears, then with his blood. So Edward II has a high consideration for ideal friendship, and that's why I call him Edward II, that he is a worshipper of idealism, meaning he has a great respectful idealistic attitude to friendship. This is one thing. Another thing is Edward II, he compares that, even history shows that King Alexander, Hercules, they have their great friends, and King Edward II also justifies his position that it is not harm to have great friend. Overall, King Edward II as a tragic protagonist. Though King Edward II could not impress us as a king, he could not impress us as a husband, could not impress us as a father, but his suffering during the banishment of Gaveston, his suffering in the prison, when he was taken into the custody by the peers, the barons. Okay, when King Edward II was taken into the custody by the barons and he was pathetically tortured, and finally he was stamped to death. In such a situation, nobody can ignore his character. Everybody must invite some drops of tears and sorrow for King Edward II. Come to the character of Gabstone. Gabstone is basically another second important character of the play. And what is more important about Gabstone? He is essentially known as the friend of King Edward II. The moment he comes back to England, his friend King Edward arranges great entertainment, wanton pleasures, wanton poets, and lascivious shows were arranged for him. We know that what kind of a deep friendship they enjoyed, they shared together. So the character of Gabstone should be considered as a friend of King Edward II. That is the one aspect of the character. What is the another aspect of the character? Gabstone is as a corrupter of the king. The moment Gabstone comes back, King Edward II starts spending money lasciviously. And this is how Gabstone somehow ruins the treasury of the kingdom. Okay, all the good and fundamental features in the king was corrupted by Gabstone. So the second aspect of the character of Gabstone is that Gabstone, we consider him as a corrupter of the king, meaning all good things in the King Edward was being corrupted by Gabstone. Then finally, the moment Gabstone comes back to the state and the king starts spending money, the king starts neglecting royal responsibility. We have to consider two different aspects of the character of Gabstone. When Gabstone comes back, King Edward II starts spending money. This is one thing. And the second important thing is King Edward II starts neglecting the royal responsibility. And this is how P.R. Gabstone becomes a kind of an enemy to the state. We can say that enemy of the state. And the fourth important aspect of the character of Gabstone loves to wear the costly dresses. Gabstone loves to wear the costly creams and cosmetics and jewelries. And this is how in the accompaniment of Edward II, Gabstone enjoys a pleasure-seeking life. Last but the non-least important thing is Gabstone as an unlawful fellow. Unlawful fellow signifies that Gabstone does not bother any law. Gabstone does not bother the state. What he only considers King Edward II as his friend and a pleasure-seeking life. And this is how he was gradually becoming an unlawful fellow and undoubtedly an enemy to the state. Then come to the character of younger Mortimer. Undoubtedly, younger Mortimer is supposed to be the most important character of the play, Edward II. Younger Mortimer as a leader. So this is something where we need to spend some 2 or 3 minutes, that when Gabstone comes back to England, when Gabstone was invited back and Gabstone started spending life with King Edward II, and the King Edward II started neglecting his duty, it was younger Mortimer who raised his voice against Gabstone and against the king. And this is how younger Mortimer was gradually appearing as a leader character. And not only that, this is how he was gradually not only a leader, but rather he was becoming a organizer. Why? Because he was organizing people against Gabstone and against the king. And this is how he was gradually becoming a great leader come organizer. And the second important aspect of the character of younger Mortimer, that younger Mortimer is a good speaker. He is a flawless speaker. flawless orator, meaning he has the natural gift of oratory, and with his oratory, with his natural gift of speech, he impressed people, and he basically organized people against the King Edward II and against Gaveston. So we have so far come across the two different aspects of the character of younger Mortimer. One, he is a great leader who conducted the rest of the earls and barons against the king, against Gaveston, and he is a good speaker, meaning he has a convincing power of impressing anybody. Third important aspect of the character of younger Mortimer, at the beginning, when Edward II invited Gaveston and he was spending lascivious time in the palace, okay, the character of younger Mortimer emerged almost as a patriot, but there is undoubtedly, surely, a turn round in his character from a patriot. Okay, his patriotic spirit will soon become the spirit of a lover. We know that the fourth important aspect of the character of younger Mortimer. Younger Mortimer was the leader, so Queen Isabella, she came to get some help from younger Mortimer, and probably while helping Queen Isabella, regarding Gaveston's arrest and etc. During this time, it was discovered that probably younger Mortimer deeply infatuated by Queen Isabella, and this is how the character of younger Mortimer simply was transforming itself from a patriot to a lover of Queen Isabella. The last important thing about the character of younger Mortimer is very serious. That is, younger Mortimer is a Machiavellian character. You may have some doubt that what is Machiavellian character. In fact, Machiavelli, in his famous book, The Prince, he mentioned some criteria of a Machiavellian character. Who is a Machiavellian character? Machiavellian character are generally power hungry. They are basically hungry for power, and not only hungry for power, to get the power they can make any kind of compromise. So hunger for power, compromise to achieve the same power, these are the two criteria of a Machiavellian character. The third important character is undoubtedly that for this very same power and ambition, okay, this ambition for power will bring the downfall. So hunger for ambition, hunger for power, compromise for power, and the very same ambition will bring the destruction. Okay, this is something that we come across in the character of younger Mortimer. Younger Mortimer, first he protested the basically negligence of the king. Then he has the ambition of becoming the king himself. And while becoming the king himself, he was ultimately banished into the tower. So his pride, his ambition, his greed ultimately became the cause of his downfall. Then come final character of Queen Isabella. So what happens here? Queen Isabella as a queen, we must consider that before the return of Pierre Gaveston, Queen Isabella as a queen, she was the most happy woman. But what happens there? The moment Gaveston comes back, his happiness as a queen really vanishes. She describes herself as a miserable queen. This is the one aspect of the character. What is the second aspect of the character? Queen Isabella as a wife. When Queen Isabella saw that her husband Edward II was spending too much time with Pierre Gaveston, okay, she was desperately trying to quit her husband from that kind of a bad habit. But ultimately she fails and she takes the assistance of younger Mortimer, and we know that probably this could not save her from her misery. Okay, Queen Isabella, when there comes a moment when Queen Isabella realizes that probably if she can brings Gabstone back to her husband, probably in the exchange of that, probably she will get the love from her husband. So this is where Queen Isabella functions as a savior. She saves Gabstone so that she can say that, so that she can get love from her husband back. But ultimately this effort also fails. The fourth important aspect of the younger, basically the character of Queen Isabella, is that Queen Isabella as a mother. We have not seen Queen Isabella, her much anxiety regarding her son Prince Edward II. We have not seen that thing. But in the final scene, when King Edward II was dead, when Prince Edward became the Prince of England, we have seen that Prince Edward, he did not show any kind of mercy to the mother, as Prince Edward banished younger Mortimer to the tower, and he equally remained merciless to the mother. So Queen Isabella as a mother undoubtedly is not a remarkable character. As I have mentioned earlier, that when you read the plays of Marlowe, women character does not feature the important places. Okay, but overall, when you consider the character of Queen Isabella, she is a pathetic woman. She may not be a tragic woman character, but her condition as a whole, as a woman, as a queen, as a mother, as a lover, can be said that she is a pathetically suffering woman. Okay, probably a woman of her place probably deserves a better life, but in the case of Queen Isabella, she lives really a very pathetic life.